Welcome to the November 17th, 1992 meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. The first item we have tonight are the minutes of our previous meeting. Do we have any comments on the minutes as prepared?
Madam Chair, only one small typo. Paragraph in the middle of the first page, last sentence, road standards. Not starters. Otherwise, another stellar job.
Another incredible job. I read these, I don't have a pencil in my hand. Yes.
Great job.
Very good job.
I move that we accept the minutes with that one small amendment.
Any second? All those in favor, raise your right hands. Opposed? That's unanimous. Welcome this evening, Peter Wilcox. Mark, sorry. Oh, well. So that's the only mistake I've made this year so far. That's it. It'll be all over. Welcome to the Planning Board, and I'm sure you'll have a great time here. We all have just a barrel of laughs one month after another. Thank you. Thanks. Good. Welcome aboard. Let's see. We have this evening, we had some items of correspondence that came before us this month. The first is a Conservation Commission comments on In by the Sea, a memo preserving affordable housing workshop notice, an Environment and Development October newsletter, Maine Growth Management news bulletin, a summary of the Kulash presentation, a letter to Robert Cram with regard to In by the Sea, a letter from the town attorney with reference to Ramshead subdivision, a memorandum from the fire chief with reference to Ramshead subdivision, a memorandum from the public works director regarding Ramshead, and a memorandum from the police chief regarding Ramshead. The first order of business tonight is Ramshead subdivision. I have to excuse myself from this, and Janet McKay will be filling in my stead.
Madam Chair, could I just make one comment?
Yes.
I wanted to thank the planner very much for the Maine Growth Management News Bulletin and the summary of the Kulash presentation in particular. I thought they were wonderful and very helpful.
Thank you. Candies.
Good evening. The Ramshead subdivision is a request by Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers of Ramshead, a four-lot subdivision located south of Ram Island Farm. We have the application has been deemed complete. A public hearing was held, I believe, in June. Perhaps the way to begin this thing this evening, I guess I'd like some suggestions from the board. Perhaps the planner could discuss the most recent revisions to the plan and get us up to date so that we will be able to use our time well this evening.
I'd be happy to go over the most recent revisions. The board may also want to ask the applicant to add to that. Mm-hmm. My understanding is that I think there are three major issues that are outstanding. The first one is the performance guarantee. There's still some discussion over what the guarantee is supposed to cover. The town engineer and I agree that on the items that it is supposed to cover in the past, in particular, the board has required the performance guarantee to cover monumentation. And in fact, that was one of the items that the money from the Elizabeth Farms performance guarantee was used to do in addition to finishing up the road. So I would agree with the town engineer and all of his recommendations in that particular item. Second, on the dead-end road requirement, there is an outstanding issue as to whether or not the subdivision requirement also applies to this particular subdivision. I believe the board would remember that this is something that you and the council worked on probably about a year ago. It's my understanding that the intent as well as the language of the ordinance amendment is supposed to apply to all streets, and any new subdivision would come under the requirement. The most recent subdivision that this was used on was the Highland subdivision. And I think you do have some memos from town staff that these are the same staff people that helped draft the amendment, and they are just outlining their position on this particular project in light of how closely they worked in drafting the original amendment. The last item is the open space requirement. Again, this is an outstanding issue where in past subdivisions, an applicant has the option of either dedicating 10% of the land of the subdivision as open space or paying a fee. There's no record of any applicant opting to pay a fee. In all cases, there has been land set aside either as a conservation easement, as a public access easement or trail, or as an outright donation of land, or a combination of the three, based on the particular physical characteristics of that subdivision. Neither one of these options has been exercised by the applicant at this time. The one thing I would like to point out to the board and hope that it is entered as part of the record is the memorandum you received this evening, which is just outlining the impact of new subdivisions and growth within the community and how it would impact the existing amount of open space in town if there was not a requirement that additional open space and recreational areas are added as more land in the town is subdivided. I'd be happy to answer any questions the board has.
Thank you, Maureen. As usual, I forgot that we are at less than full capacity this evening. I note that Judith Kane has stepped down, has recused herself from this issue as she has in the past, and that Tom Emery is not here. So I appoint Judy Lardner as a voting member for this particular issue. And Mark, I guess I would ask you, this is your first night on the planning board, but we do have a vacancy for this matter. So if you'd like to join us, we'd be happy to have you as a voting member. I leave it to your discretion. Yes.
I have reviewed a package of correspondence, but since in the past presentations for this case, I have not been present at the workshops or heard any of the presentations, I really don't feel it would be fair to jump in at this point and exercise a voting.
Fair enough. We will respect your decision on that, and we'll be four strong tonight until Mr. Emery arrives, if he does during this time. I guess before we go any further, I would like, just for the benefit of the people at home, to very briefly summarize the letters that we have gotten that were mentioned earlier in the correspondence received. One is dated November the 12th from Chief McGoldrick, the fire department. I don't intend to read them word for word into the record, but he indicates that with regard to the question of Ramshead subdivision, he feels that with the safety issue, a second means of access should be made available, that it was clear that to him that the intent of the requirements is to restrict development that over time may diminish public safety. I also note that we've had a memorandum from Bob Malley, the Public Works Director, dated November the 12th, 1992, with respect to Ramshead subdivision, which is a one-page memorandum, but concludes that based on these observations, he feels the current dead-end street standard should apply to the proposed subdivision at Ramshead. We also have a letter dated November the 10th, 1992, from Chief Pickering, the police chief, with respect to public access. And if I can very easily summarize it, he says that after reviewing the plans of the proposed Ramshead subdivision, he would like to go on record as recommending that a secondary emergency access be provided before approval. And we also have the town attorney's letter of November the 9th responding to Mr. Chenet's letter of October the 30th. Mr. Chenet is arguing that the dead-end road standard should not apply to this subdivision, and Mr. Hill rebuts that argument and indicates that as far as his advice is concerned, that it's not exempted from the subdivision ordinance. I do note for the record also that the town attorney, Michael Hill, is here this evening to answer questions if the board has any. How would the board like to proceed from here? Do board members have particular questions? Would you like to hear from the applicant?
Madam Chair, I'd like to supplement any of our additions to what the applicant might add to that, and then we can jump into some questions real quickly.
Mr. Chenet, are you designated?
My name is Rick Chenet. I'm an attorney with the Drummond Woodson, Plimpton, and McMahon in Portland. I represent Mr. Sprague, the applicant, who is here tonight, along with Brad here, our consultant. I'd like to, number of things I want to talk about tonight, and I'd hope that I'm not up here to debate legal issues with Michael Hill. Suffice it to say that I categorically disagree with his categorical dismissal of our position on this. Nevertheless, I don't want to lecture and get into a debate about the law or interpretation, except to say that we stand behind our position on that. I'd also like to go on the record as saying, to get a memo like this 5 minutes before we get here with a number of factual representations that I have no way of verifying, and furthermore, lumping Mr. Sprague into the Sprague Corporation holdings is simply unfair. I mean, we're only talking about a four-lot subdivision here. Maureen's memo states something that's just simply wrong. The property that abuts this project is owned by the Sprague Corporation, not a trust of which Shaw Sprague is a beneficiary. Shaw is a beneficiary of a trust which holds stock in the Sprague Corporation. We don't have any control over what happens on the Sprague Corporation land. Shaw's not a member of the board of directors. He is simply a beneficiary of an entity that holds stock in that. This memo talks about, I haven't had a chance to digest this, but this talks about things that potentially could happen on an awful lot of property that's nothing to do with this project. So I really, I think it's unfair to throw this at us this late date. After that introduction, I do want to address one minor point.
Madam Chair, just not to interrupt.
I'd prefer the interruptions because I hope
get
a brief vote.
Typically, we look at those memos as board members the same way whenever we get anything on the podium. The night that we sit down here, I've only got halfway through it, and it's too much to try to decipher absolute truth from calculations and mathematical whatever. So, in general, when we get them here, we push them aside, try to stay away from using those as discussion pieces at the planning board.
I appreciate that. If it's intended to show that this project has some kind of quantifiable impact, I take exception to that. The other thing, preliminary thing I want to talk about briefly, last meeting, a letter from Mike McGovern was read into the record that when I read it, I felt that there had been a misinterpretation of my comments at the last meeting, the September 15th meeting. I called Mike and apologized for his interpretation of what he thinks I said, and I also called Maureen and apologized, and I want to publicly apologize tonight. I want to make it clear, no one said to us, particularly Mr. McGovern, if you don't give us an easement to that beach, you're not getting approval. What I was trying to say at the last meeting was the comments I was getting here at the meetings, the discussions I had outside the meeting, a review of your comprehensive plan, which has a quote in it that says something like the town should not miss any opportunity to acquire access to the beach, led me to advise Mr. Sprague that I felt we had a real tough row to hoe here if we didn't concede on this issue. I did not, however, intend by my comments to imply that Mr. McGovern said anything other than a free flow discussion about what the town's intent was in the whole thing. So I do apologize for Mr. McGovern's for that misinterpretation. We're here tonight to request, obviously, final approval. And I think Maureen has fairly stated what we understand to be the remaining open issues. The first is the performance guarantee. The second is the open space issue. And third and most significant is the dead-end road issue. we will meet whatever the town's requirements are on the performance guarantee. You have it as a condition in your proposed approval. We don't have any problem with it. On the open space requirement, at the last meeting, we talked a lot about public access, and it's my understanding that we reached a, my sense of the board's decision, or not sense of the board, where the board was on that, is that public access would not be required to this project, and I think Mr. Hill has advised you that that cannot be a condition of your approval. With that behind us, we in good faith went back to the plan based upon concerns that had been expressed to us by you and by Maureen that something more had to be done to guarantee that the sand dune area, the entire beach area, particularly the sand dune of Lot 4, would remain open and undeveloped and in its natural state. I think at one point there had been some concern about, well, what if the laws change and he can do something there? I don't think that's ever going to happen in my lifetime, but nevertheless, we appreciate the board's concerns. So we have gone back to the plan and added a restriction. Part of the plan, part of your approval, can't be changed without the board's vote, that essentially restricts that area of the project, the critical wetland zone, to no further development. The only exception is we're asking the ability to maintain the power lines that currently run through it. Now, we're going to have that on the plan. It's going to be, you're going to approve that plan, hopefully. We can't arbitrarily change it without your approval in the future. We will reference it in each deed. It'll be a condition that will run with the land and will be binding upon the lot and will be enforceable by all the lot owners. I'm more than happy to amend our general declaration of restrictions to incorporate that so that effectively it cannot be changed without the unanimous approval of all the lot owners and, most importantly, this board. And we think that ought to be sufficient to address the open space issue. We would prefer not to go the further route of a conservation easement. I don't think that does anything different. It simply introduces another party into the process that could be amended just as easily with consent of the parties. And it also brings up the issue of access by a third party to this project, which we have said time and again we are concerned about. So we'd like to think that our proposal addresses and satisfies the open space issue by restricting any further development for scenic value on the beach area. You have a scenic view plan that I've read. The town in all its ordinances puts a heavy emphasis on the scenic beauty of this town. The view of that area from the water, which is the only place it can be seen from, we think is a reasonable response to your open space requirement. And we'd hope that the board would determine that that satisfies that condition. Lastly, the dead end street issue. I want to make think. It's been said here tonight, it's been said in correspondence, that we are objecting to the application of that standard to this project. I'm standing up here tonight to tell you we are not objecting, and we do not, it is not our position that that standard doesn't apply to this project. If we had a road within the project in excess of 2,000 feet, we would have to do something about it. We are simply saying that the public road that gets down to this area shouldn't be included in the calculation of the length of the dead-end road condition. Plain and simple. I think that that's the focus of the ordinance. The subdivision as a whole looks at the project, looks at the roads, other facilities within the project, means of access to the project. We're not being asked to make any other changes to the public road, although I note that the street standards would presumably require us to put the power lines under the ground that are on the public road. Furthermore, I've gone back and done a considerable amount of research yesterday in your ordinances to try to track down this issue of the provision that we cite as supporting our position that it was never the intent of the town in drafting its subdivision and street ordinance to include public streets. And I recognize that you've told us, but that's exactly what we've done with the Highlands. I don't think what you've done there, right or wrong, should be any relevance to the issue that because the issue's here tonight and we're asking you to consider it. We think that it's clear, contrary to Mr. Hill's statement, we think it's just as clear to read that provision as we read it, that it was never the intent of the town to basically prohibit any subdividing in this part of town without another road through. It's just, it just doesn't make any sense. If we were going to do a simple three-lot subdivision, all with frontage on that road, and each lot had its own driveway, I don't think there's a person in this town who would think that's not an appropriate, approvable subdivision. Yet, your interpretation says because those three lots with driveways spilling out onto Charles Jordan Road don't have a second means of access, you can't do it. A minor subdivision, virtually no impact, yet we'd have to build a major road that obviously would have considerable impact on the rest of that property just to do a simple three-lot subdivision with frontage on that road. And essentially that's what we're doing, except that we're at the end of the road as opposed to beside the road. So we feel pretty strongly that the provisions of the ordinance are intended to apply to the subdivision only, and that the public roads were never intended to be included in that count. Now, we also want to again return to this issue of access to this project over the Sprague Corporation land. We have made sincere efforts to try to negotiate something. And suffice it to say that the corporation is not interested in providing us any kind of specific emergency access easement or whatever over the existing road that runs through Sprague Corporation land to this project. I have tried. We have had many discussions. I've met with Bob Monks Jr. I have talked with their attorney. We have sent them information. We have made every effort. Path of least resistance. Rather than have to deal with this issue the way we're dealing with it tonight, we have tried. We have been unsuccessful. But I point out to you, I have sent you a letter before that points to language in Shaw's deed that says he has a right to use all the existing roads across the former land of Charles Edwin Jordan, whether now existing or hereafter constructed. That language appeared in the 1941 deed that conveyed this lot, first created this lot, out of the then, it was Shaw Properties, Maine, to Shaw's grandfather. We've looked at the title, and admittedly, it's complicated. We have boxes and boxes and boxes of title records on this property. It is not easy to work through, but as best as I can tell, we think we have rights to use that road across the corporation's property. What you've asked us to do is go back and get something else, and we haven't been able to get that. But we believe we have those rights. The trouble is, you know, if we had to make an issue of that, we might be suing the corporation, and obviously Shaw doesn't want to sue family members. But suffice it to say that we're satisfied that the original Charles Edwin Jordan holdings most likely included that area that runs whatever the direction is from the road, across the road, out to 77. We probably have rights to use that road anyway. Furthermore, the town, as a matter of common law, would have the right to cross that road to deal with an emergency on abutting property. I mean, it's a common law right. And the town already has a key to the gate that goes into that road. It's not like nobody has ever thought about using that road for access to that area. The town has a key. We verified that today with Mr. Sylvie. He has a key. They have instructions about what to do with that gate in the event the key doesn't work. They apparently have instructions on how to cut. It's a mechanical cable that pulls it back and forth. They have permission to do that. They have the ability to do that. Obviously, Bob Monks would, and the others that live down there would like to be able to have fire trucks and emergency vehicles get down there. That road is going to stay open for for all intents and purposes, because it provides access to homes down there. It doesn't make any sense that anybody's going to close it down. Those of you who have been down there know that the road swings off down into this project. Now, admittedly, the stretch that goes down in this project, although passable, needs some work. And we're prepared to undertake, you know, whatever we can do, short of having to disturb wetlands and the like, we'll improve it. And we're willing to agree that we will continue to keep that road plowed, the bad stretch, so that it remains open, so that there won't be any question that, in a pinch, emergency vehicles can get down there. Now, we're not talking about an event that's going to occur day to day. I mean, think of the things that have to happen before anybody's going to drive a fire truck down that road. Obviously, the main road has got to be blocked off. Admittedly, that could happen. But the likely occurrence of that seems to me to be fairly remote. So there exists a means of access to the property. Granted, it needs some work. Shaw is prepared to improve that stretch of road within the project so that it's passable. We'll agree to keep it open. I think it's a fair assumption that the stretch that serves the Monks portion of the property, I call it the Monks property, it's the corporation's property, they live down there, is going to stay open. The town already is using it. They have a key to the gate. You know, practically speaking, the purpose of your ordinance, the underlying purpose, is going to be satisfied because there is an ability to get to this project across another road. I cannot stress enough, we're only talking about a small four-lot subdivision, two of the lots of which already have houses on them. We are not talking about a major subdivision. We're not talking about something that's going to add 15 or 20 houses. We're talking about a very small subdivision that, you know, quite honestly, we're surprised at how controversial it has become. We don't know why, but it has become that. And you know, we feel that we have met, we can meet the spirit of the ordinance without having to go anything further on the right-of-way. We're not willing to concede that that public road ought to be counted. But practically speaking, there already exists a road that you can use to get to this property in an emergency. So I had hoped we could discuss this tonight. We very much would like to have a decision tonight, one way or the other. Char has come all the way from California again to be here in hopes that we can get this settled tonight. And I'm happy to answer questions and respond to whatever concerns you have.
Thank you, Rick.
Do you want me to stay up here? How do you want
Why
to
don't
this?
You? I think I suspect.
No, I'd say no. No, just kidding. thanks, Rick. I would actually like to hear from our town legal counsel to respond specifically to legal opinion on the example of the three-lot subdivision. How this four-lot subdivision differs from, if it does, the example given. From three lots that are directly accessed by driveway to the Charles E. Jordan Road, how that would vary from the present application before.
We brought visual aids tonight. We have done up, Michael and Richard.
Hi, Rick.
We have brought a major subdivision before you tonight to give you an example of
Mr. Cheney.
Yeah.
I would like to have Mr. Hill respond.
Just, you know, he's going to talk about this. I want to show you what we're talking about.
No, that's okay, Rick. You can sit down. I appreciate the visuals.
The visuals might help me. I think that the difference is that first, I guess I want to make sure that I understand your question.
My question is in that introduction, the example was given that the three-lot subdivision with direct driveway access onto Charles E. Jordan would be, correct me if I'm wrong, no different than The proposed four-lot subdivision, let's make it four houses added. Would your same opinion apply to the three or four lots added to Charles E. Jordan in that instance?
And each lot had a 9,000-foot driveway out to the road?
No. They're each adding a 100-foot driveway to the 9,000-foot long. But I take it, and I will refer back to Mr. Cheney, that is one subdivision being approved. Is the example that you give? I mean, it's a good example.
I don't think, correct me if I'm wrong, but your interpretation is, should I have this thing? Can I do what Johnny?
Well, if you can just do it briefly.
I'm saying if that would not be approved on Charles E. Jordan Road, if the distance from here to 77 were in excess of 2,000 feet, using your definition, even though three lots, each with its own 50-foot driveway, whatever, trouble is that there's a dead-end road, according to your definition, from 77 to here, therefore, that can't be approved. If it was three lots and it had a loop road out, it couldn't be approved. I mean, your interpretation of the ordinance.
That's correct. I think that's quite correct.
Yeah.
Very clear.
Well, okay. I think that that's unreasonable and an arbitrary application of your ordinance.
Okay, so the only other thing I'd ask you, do you have any further comment on your written opinion that you sent to us?
No, I think I was fairly clear in that opinion. I think that we do need to include in the computation exactly what the ordinance requests, that we measure the dead end from the point at which there's only one means of access, and that would make this be 9,000 or 9,500. I'm not sure exactly what the number is. It's in excess of 2,000 feet.
Okay. I guess Maureen looks like she has a comment to make.
I just wanted to take this unique opportunity to agree with Mr. Cheney in that, yes, this would apply in this case, that you would not be able to approve this. I also would like to be able to share with the board some of the discussions that occurred with the department heads when the original ordinance was drafted. I'm not sure how many board members remember, but the original limit to a dead-end road was 1,000 feet in length, and there was supposed to be there was a question as to whether or not the board could waive that standard, and that's when it went back for further revisions. And department heads really spent a lot of time in weighing the amount of risk, and that's really where the standard sits, is how much risk are you willing to assume and how far is too much. That's why the standard is currently written as 2,000 feet in length rather than 1,000, where it specifically says the board cannot waive the length. It clarifies that the measurement must be from where the dead-end condition exists, because, again, the community has to deal with this from where the dead-end condition exists. How much risk are you willing to assume? And the limit is not just 2,000 feet. It's also 20 homes. So department heads kind of uncomfortably agreed to lengthen the maximum limit on a dead-end road, but at the same time, this kind of subdivision would not be allowed. I would like to point out that if this was not three lots but two lots, it would not fall under the subdivision ordinance. It would be merely creation of an additional lot, and it would be allowed. So again, there is some recognition that a certain amount of additional risk and cumulative growth is being allowed by the town, but that at some point you have to draw the line.
I'll say that I was a board member at that time, and the feelings of the department heads at that time was very strong, as it seems to be with their letters to the board this time around, along with the legal opinion. As just one board member, I see a pretty difficult situation to disagree with both our legal counsel and the town staff on theirs and our interpretation of the dead-end road ordinance. The question I had, do you want to stay on one topic before we go on to other issues? Again, as one board member, I look favorably upon your suggestion for the area designated, but I just want to make sure that I understand what you're intending to do. Number one, you're listing or making a note to the plan that the area designated, actually it doesn't say that. Say it says that the wetlands, critical wetlands area will be, that no further development can be permitted within that portion of Lot 4 located within the critical wetland protection zone. I'd like to suggest that the verbiage of that change to in the area indicated on the plan as critical wetlands area, only to if critical wetlands changes. It better delineates saying as of this date of approval that this is a line that was intended for no further development.
It was our intent to limit it to what's shown, the critical wetlands.
I thought that was the case. The other issue was on sheet 2 of 3. I don't think in that part of the plan the critical wetlands is designated. There's no line shown there unless it is all of that area. Were you intending to add a critical wetlands line?
I think we could do it if you wanted. I thought was to.
I think it's the recorded plan that
I think is going to be binding in terms of what there are for record restrictions, and that's what we focused on. Mm-hmm. It's not our intent to. Whatever is critical wetland today is what we're trying to limit.
Okay. I think if we can incorporate those, make it very clear, and I would look to other board members as far as the verbiage that makes it very clear that in perpetuity there's no further development in that section of Lot 4. My own personal opinion is that this does satisfy that section of the ordinance in a different way than we typically see in a subdivision. Approval. This is a parcel of, or a part of this parcel, which I personally think would benefit from as little traffic as possible. And as far as any easement, public access to, I think it would be detrimental to the sand dune area, to that wetlands area. The town will benefit from an additional 1,500 feet of shoreline that will visually be preserved forever. And I think as long as that end is met by narratively adding the appropriate note, I think that's quite appropriate.
That had always been our intent. We just think the note spells it out better for you.
Would you be willing to add, delineate the critical wetlands area in the in sheet? Does it go on to the recording
sure
plan
which,
itself?
I'm not sure which plan. We're talking about putting it on the what's going on the record. But you will sign the recording plan.
Right, and if you look on,
but if it needs to be repeated on other non-record plans, there's no reason why we can't.
No, this lists the recording plat.
I don't have them.
And 2 of 3 doesn't show any critical wetlands area at all. It refers to it, unless the entire section that is shown here is critical wetlands. In other words, it's not delineated on that plat.
I think the whole thing is basically 90% of Lot 4 is. I think if you look here,
that's fine. If that's
there is a line.
The issue, I mean, it notates with a squiggle.
Over is all critical wetlands. From there, the property line, all the way down the beach.
If that could be noted, that the entire area in plat or sheet 2 of 3 of the recording plat is critical wetlands, that's fine. As far as the performance guarantee, I think we need to take the lead of our. Town engineer, town manager, that the applicants indicated that they find that agreeable.
That's right. I don't understand that to be any further issue.
Good.
Thank you, Mr. Edsel. Anybody else? Ms. Lardner?
I'd like to follow up a little bit on what Steve was saying about the open space. You say point blank in there that you're following my lead. That was one of my suggestions. I wanted you guys to be creative as opposed to just saying we're not going to deal with this. And at one point I remember you saying that if there were any further restrictions put on some of this land that you would consider it a takings. Clearly, you did somewhere in here. It's in actually in one of your memos.
We've raised that a couple of times.
Here. Yes. In general, I like the approach. But what I would like to see both on the plan itself is some recognition where this requirement comes from. For instance, if you use your same note and said, in recognition of the undeveloped character, blah, 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 and the requirements of Section 16.3.1Q of the Town of Cape Elizabeth Zoning Ordinance, to recognize that you are meeting this open space requirement. And I would like to point out, I don't know exactly what this legal mechanism is called, but our Greenbelt plan does list restrictive covenants running with the land as an acceptable method of preserving land. And if the town attorney says what you're proposing is a restrictive covenant running with the land, I think that's acceptable, whether it's the usual format we use or not. On the plan itself, I would like a clear delineation saying that that is open space or restricted land, not just use the critical wetland, but on both sheets 1 of 3 and 2 of 3, very clear delineation of the area that's being protected, because it isn't clear, Steve. I agree with you.
Can I just ask, you'd like the note to say something like, in satisfaction of section thus and so of your ordinance?
I personally would like that, and if other board members agree, that meets the open space requirement. I'd like some acknowledgement that you are looking at the open space requirement, you're agreeing in some sense, and this is how you are proposing to meet it.
Off the top of my head, I don't have a problem with that.
Pardon?
I said I don't, this moment, have a problem with
okay.
that. Can I just, not to interrupt you, but I'm going to interrupt you anyway. The taking issue that we've discussed, never anything to do with this sort of a thing. The concern was public access, that's all.
No, the taking issue under natural features, I'm looking at your August 12th memo to the planning board. You're talking about the sand dune system, freshwater wetlands located in Lot 4, already heavily regulated at local, state, federal levels, blah, blah, blah. You question, therefore, the need for any further private deed restriction limiting activities in those areas. I'm reading but skipping around here. Furthermore, consistent with the principle set forth in Nolan, we believe that conditioning approval upon the imposition of further restriction upon those areas, or requiring as a condition of approval that those areas be dedicated to the town, so forth, would amount to unconstitutional takings, and we'll object to such conditions on those grounds.
We've raised so many issues that I forgot the language.
Okay. I just wanted to point that out, that I think this is could be acceptable all around. To the dead-end road standard, the board may not agree with me, but I felt all along that Shaw is owed an apology from this town, from the staff and this board, that this issue was not caught for 4 months. I think that was the problem, because if this would have been pointed out when you came to whomever you saw first, and I missed it too, I'm not blaming anybody, then you would have spent Mr. Cheney's efforts at the town council clarifying this or changing this ordinance, and I think that is almost a crime that it's been this long. However, given that, I still see no way to find that this dead-end road standard does not apply to this project. I was really hopeful, and I am still hopeful, that you will work out something with the Sprague Corporation, because if they find that a four-lot subdivision, which is in fact only adding two families, will be treated somewhat harshly by the town ordinance, they're going to be facing that a lot too. With respect to what you said, Mr. Cheney, about you feel that not only does Shaw have a right now to that access road, but that the town also has a right and we have the key and so forth. I don't, unless everyone, town staff and town council, felt comfortable with all these unwritten rights, I couldn't go along with that. If there is some legal mechanism short of granting specific access easements for the town and Mr. Sprague, that you can produce and that we can see on the plans how the road is going to be improved, and that the town staff thinks that your improvements on your land are adequate, I'm all for that. I think, you know, at no point have I been against the subdivision. I think it's very unfortunate that you've been caught in a situation that makes it look like the town may be against a four-lot subdivision. That's it.
Parker?
One question on Lot 4, is the pavilion, and are you intending to keep that there? I don't remember what it is. It's just to be maintained and, okay.
It's just just an existing, it's the same idea as the pavilion out at Two Lights State Park, out behind. It's a brick
okay.
cinder block, cement floor, roof, fireplace, barbecue pit, that sort of thing. I think it's, you know, it's going to stay.
From the plan, we have a building window depicted on Lot 4. I guess I'm a little unsure why there is any discussion about further development of the lot when there's a building window depicted on the plan, and it's my interpretation that the building, any building on that lot will be restricted to that building window.
We agree, but the majority of the board apparently didn't, so. I mean, we don't have a problem with the restriction. I agree with you. I don't think we could build there anyway, either because we're not permitted under the approved plan or existing state and federal laws probably prohibit it, but we don't have a problem with the restriction to further clarify in perpetuity that we're not planning to build there.
Okay. Just to take that one step further, can the building envelope or window be located with meets and bounds, depicted on the plan and located on the face of the earth, and that is the only place on that lot that can be built upon?
Well, it is shown to scale.
Excuse me?
It is shown on the plan to scale, and I think any competent surveyor could tell you that could be scaled out without any problem at all. Okay. So, I mean, it is essentially shown by meets and bounds by depicting a shaded area to which any surveyor with adequate tools can plot and lay it out. And presumably before anything's built there, somebody who buys that lot and builds will want to get their surveyor out there to mark those corners so it'll be built within the building window. I mean, that's incumbent upon the builder to make sure it's built there. So I think it's already adequate on the plan.
Okay, fine. The second thing, the dead-end road, I agree with Judy Lardner that if there's some way to demonstrate that there is a way to use that road across the Sprague Corporation land, I don't know how you can guarantee it, but if there's some way to demonstrate that it can be used without really any doubt in any of the board's members' minds, then I think that should solve that part of the problem. And that's all I have for comments.
Rick, I just have one question on the secondary access road issue. Am I correct in stating that the plan as currently presented actually discontinues a section of road that could be utilized for secondary access?
I don't believe so.
Maureen and I have had this discussion, Brad Hare, Land Use Consultants. Prior to the dead-end road issue coming up, we were going forward with the fact that we were going to eliminate that entire road from Lot 4 by the Japanese pond, which would connect up, you know, to Bob Monks's driveway. Absolutely. Since that time, we've gone into the dead-end road issue. We, you know, without resolution, we have not added that back in. We haven't had a final decision on anything regarding that. So that's simply a holdover from the time when the dead-end road rock hit the floor. So that's why it's still there.
Okay. Any other questions or comments from the board?
Madam Chair, I would just say, in reference to the building windows, maybe Maureen can correct me, but I mean, as far as further development would also apply to roads, fences, et cetera, and roads and fences can take place, construction can take place outside of a building window?
Yes.
Okay. I would concur. If you could simply demonstrate whatever rights and interests you have in that right-of-way, I think you know what the cure is. It's just a matter of, that appears to be the only way to successfully demonstrate a second means of access is to show your rights and interests to that right-of-way. Going back to the building windows issue, to demonstrate as a note on the plan just simply makes it a stronger statement of the dedication of that part of that parcel to be preserved. I have no other questions, comments.
Anybody else with further discussion or comments?
May I respond to a couple of things?
Yes.
Dead end road problem. Probably not going to get anywhere with this, but I'd like to point out a couple of things. The definitional issue that's causing us the problem was something that came in only last year. And it's the section of the ordinance that says a dead end street shall be measured between the points where only one means of access exists. I don't know how you can read that any other way than to say one means of access into this particular subdivision. That provision only came into existence last year. That has not been in your ordinance ad nauseum. It just isn't there. Now, if you go back in your ordinances, I did the best I could yesterday with your records. Up until fairly recently, there was never even a distance limitation. The limitation had to do with things like turnarounds, T-turnarounds, that sort of stuff. It wasn't until your 500-foot limitation came into existence, I think, early 80s, I can't be exact, but certainly not very recently. There was no limitation, there was no definition in there about this issue of what is a dead-end road for purposes of a subdivision. That definition came in last year. Prior to last year's changes in the ordinance, you had a 500-foot limitation, but you had a waiver provision. And I assume that what happened was you were routinely waiving it, or at least in many cases were waiving it so much so that the council, somebody got concerned about it. So the trade-off was, we'll give you a longer dead-end road, but we're going to take away your ability to waive this, period. And we're going to say that the dead-end road starts at the point where only one means of access exists. And again, I absolutely disagree with your interpretation of that. I believe that the interpretation should focus on the subdivision. The subdivision regulations, the public road is not part of this subdivision. It is the road into the subdivision. If it were more than 2,000 feet, we would have to provide some other way, means of access into the subdivision. Your interpretation makes that whole parcel of land, it can't be subdivided until another road is built in there. And I think that is a misinterpretation of the intent. Now, I had drafted a letter that I didn't get Mr. Hill's letter until last week. I didn't have your package. I didn't want to bombard you with letters. But I drafted a letter, which I'd like to read into the record for what it's worth, that I didn't deliver tonight because I didn't want to be accused of hitting you at the 11th hour with some other argument. But I'd like to read my letter. It's addressed to the Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board, care of Maureen, stated today. Dear board members, this letter is in response to Michael Hill's letter of November 9th regarding our position on the applicability of Section 16-3-2 sub A9 of the Town of Cape Elizabeth subdivision regulations to Ramshead subdivision. Before I address Mr. Hill's specific comments, however, I would want to emphasize that it is not our position that Section 16-3-2-A9 is inapplicable to this project. Rather, it is our position that this section should not be applied to the existing public roads leading to the project. That being the case, the length of the Charles E. Jordan and Fowler roads should not be included in determining the length of the dead-end condition within the project. We believe our interpretation is consistent with the overall focus of the regulations, which is on the subdivision itself, and as to this section, the roads within it. We further believe that Section 16.3.6 sub B is consistent with and supports this interpretation. Turning to Mr. Hill's letter, he states that the roads are not within the category of streets described in the savings clause of 16.3.6b due to their failure to meet two of the three criteria set forth in that section. First, he states that no evidence has been presented that the design of the roads was approved by the town engineer prior to March 13, 1968. Second, he states that no evidence has been presented that the roads were under actual construction as of March 12, 1968. As to the first criterion, Brad Hare has talked with Robert Malley, the Public Works Director, and Mr. Malley has advised Mr. Hare that the roads were laid out and accepted by the town in 1897. We think it is reasonable to conclude that the town reviewed and approved the design of the roads at the time of their acceptance, consistent with the then common practice through the appropriate town official responsible for such matters. As to the second criterion, Mr. Hill's interpretation of Section 16.36 sub B would lead to the rather odd conclusion that all streets previously approved and completed prior to March 12, 1968 would be subject to the regulations because they were, quote, not under actual construction as of March 12, 1968. We find it hard to believe that this was the town's intent. Rather, the, quote, under construction, unquote, requirement of Section 16.36B was presumably included to address the status of approved streets under construction as of March 12, 1968, while not intending to exclude all previously approved and completed streets. In other words, Section 16.36B was intended to apply to all previously approved streets completed as of October 14, 1968, as long as construction had commenced on or before March 12, 68. Only approved streets on which construction was commenced after March 12, 1968, as well as all future streets, were to be subject to the regulations. A street which had been approved, constructed, and completed many years prior to 1968 would obviously meet the criteria of Section 16.36B and would thus not be subject to the regulations. Mr. Hill also notes that the board has recently applied Section 16.32A9 to the Highlands at Broad Cove subdivision. The manner in which that section was applied to that project should not necessarily be determinative of its application to this project, particularly when a question of interpretation now exists. We respectfully request, therefore, that the board conclude that the length of Charles E. Jordan and Fowler Road should not be included in determining the length of the dead-end condition within the project, and that the project thus complies with Section 16.32A9. And I'll be happy to provide you a clean copy of this for the record tomorrow.
Thank you, Mr. Chenin.
I would like 5 minutes to speak with my client, if that's permissible.
Madam Chair, I might suggest that we take a 5 minute break to coincide with our break.
We'll have a 5 minute break. Things among yourselves, we went into executive session and now we reconvene. So would you like to say anything further?
Brad, we'd like to get everything out on tape. We can't. Brad has some comments that I think will be enlightening. We'd like to provide them to you.
If you'll indulge me one more time, I appreciate it.
Just this once.
Okay, just this once. I'd like to bring forward a little bit of my history regarding this part of the ordinance and why I think that you're in the position to basically see it our way, if I may say so. There were two projects that got caught up in this, the ordinance switchover at the regarding the dead end road issue. One was Stonegate, and the other was Spurwink Woods by Ed Drinan. My office was involved with one of them full-time at that point, and another one, partially. So I have a little bit of history regarding this. And it seems hard for me, having gone through the ordinance change, to sit here and be able to look at this project and see how it applies in a different way. There was no public dead-end road issue at Spurwink Woods. There was no public dead-end road issue at Stonegate. So how in the world could that come up in that process when, in reality, there's no other situation in town like this? You know, there's only two other roads in town that you can possibly have the situation occur, and that's Hannaford Cove Road, which is already all developed, and Two Lights Road, past the 2,000 foot pass where the road splits. you know, which is occupied. There's no land left there to do that. So I find it kind of hard going through this process of switching from the old ordinance to the new ordinance to come to grips with the fact that that definition somehow assumed a public dead-end road would count, when in fact none of those two projects, none of any projects in town, have ever had this happen in my knowledge before, or can in the future. The only land that this affects is Sprague land. The only road that this affects is the Charles E. Jordan Road. So, in essence, you know, that definition, when it was installed in 1991, I find it very hard to agree with the fact that everyone took into consideration the one road in town where this could apply, when no one really knew that this situation existed. But I do, however, see how this definition can be reapplied, with assuming a couple things, to this project, you know, and cause us, you know, great harm. And I would further go on to say that I know it was an embarrassing moment for the board, as Judy said, but I think that no one caught this 4 or 5 months into the project, because no one would ever assume that this was how it was. The intent is not to create in a subdivision a road longer than 2,000 feet without a second means of access. We're not here tonight creating a 2,000-foot long road. We're here tonight creating a 600-foot long road. Now, thinking of it that way, you know, I think you have the power to agree with us. Or, you know, you have the power to disagree with us. But I find it very hard to believe that dead-end road issue relates to the one road in town that it could happen on. And I find it very hard, the intent of the council is to limit the one road that it does, when in reality the problem was created by other subdivisions in other parts of town, not on dead-end roads, and don't have this situation occurring. The Highlands, we keep referring to the Highlands, but Peter Kennedy has two access points of two different roads, Broad Cove and Route 77. So I fail to see how that applies to us, when Broad Cove has two means of access. It's been failed to be constructed after, even when it's been approved. It has a second means of access in the Stonecrest. Just no one has taken the time and the effort to get to pave it. And the Highlands has two means of access. It, you know, it's not connected, but it has emergency access. So I don't see how that relates to Shaw's piece of land on a public road, you know, albeit a dead-end road. So I could see how a definition like this can be twisted, but I, in all common sense and applying it how it's been applied before, I just can't believe that this can be applied to this, and that's really all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hale. Ms. Lardner.
I'd like to comment on that and what Mr. Chenet said earlier before we all adjourn. I agree this language needs to be clarified. I think, I personally think it's weighted more to what the town has been stating. I can see the dual reading, though. And I agree, in one way or another, this issue should be addressed by the council. You've cited that the ordinance is only a year or so old, and I think in one way, again, that weighs favors what the town is saying, because I think the intent is clear. We have the people who worked on the ordinance saying this was our intent, whether you agree with it or not. Thirdly, you do have the option, if you think this is not what the council intended, by all means go to the town council, have this clarified, and come forward. But I feel if you absolutely force a vote tonight and you do not wish to be tabled so you can resolve this, I, as one board member, can only vote against it based on that.
Mr. Chenet.
You have it within your authority under the Subdivision Act to interpret your ordinances, and we're asking you to make an interpretation. And my sense is it isn't going to be in our favor. We have considered the option of going to the council. we don't see any likelihood of success. I mean, that, what are we going to do? Go to the council and say, change an ordinance that you spent, I don't know how much time doing just a year ago. I mean, we're probably not going to be successful. I think this particular situation screams out for a waiver, but you can't waive it. Now, if we go to the council and we ask them, would you be willing to amend the ordinance provision to permit the planning board to waive the condition in a minor subdivision situation? Let's say we're successful. We come back here, we ask for a waiver, and you flat turn us down because every letter that you've gotten says you've got to have emergency access to this property. So we're another 3 months down the road, and we're no further along than we were today. My sense is that we have done everything possible. I can only say that we think we have rights to a second means of access. It exists. It's usable. It's a minor subdivision. You have it within your authority to interpret these provisions to say, either way, it doesn't apply to the public roads, or there is a second means of access that ought to be adequate under the circumstances. You have it within your authority to make that decision tonight. But I've got to tell you that we're at our wit's end on this project. To a certain extent, we feel we have been treated unfairly. I don't think that Shaw would have gone ahead on this if he had known at the very first meeting, before we even came to you, when we had our planning meeting, you got a problem with dead-end roads here. And nobody raised that problem because nobody even considered until five meetings into this effort that that might be a problem. I don't know why it happened that way. I'm amazed. Maureen was the prime draftsperson on that, I understand. It was a very serious issue in this town. I'm told it was intended to address Broad Cove. And here we are, five meetings into it at considerable cost and effort, and we're stonewalled. So why aren't we going to the council? We don't think we're going to get anywhere. I mean, it seems to me that it's a pointless effort. So we'd like you to approve the subdivision tonight, and I think you can do it. And I don't see that you're going to cause any harm in this town. There's no other place, for all intents and purposes, where the issue is going to come up again. We are not the Sprague Corporation. We are not here asking you to permit us to subdivide the Sprague Corporation land. No, nothing is before you on the Sprague Corporation. We're asking you to deal with a small four-lot subdivision. But be that as it may, if you're not willing to go that way, we've talked, and I don't know how you want to do this, but I guess we'd either like an up or down vote tonight, but I would like to ask that if you're going to deny us, that these findings of fact need to be discussed a little bit on the denial. I mean, in good faith, we have worked through all the other issues, and Maureen's memo tonight says there are three issues. By my count, we have dismissed two of them. They have been satisfied. We have agreed to do the performance guarantee, but that's a condition of approval you can add on if you vote us up tonight anyway. And we have addressed and we understand in good faith we have satisfied your open space issue. So there remains only the dead end road thing. Yet the findings of fact that Maureen has drafted drag back in all the other issues again. And we think it's, you're talking about fundamental fairness here. We have addressed everything but the dead end road. And so I would like to request that if you're going to deny us tonight, that you cut back these findings of fact so that they deal simply with a denial based upon our inability to meet the requirements of the dead-end road standard, period. I mean, I just don't think it's fair that we work through all these things and now you deny us and drag on. I mean, you know what's going on here. I'm going to have to play games with this. It's not fair to us to deny us on issues that we have in good faith satisfied so that there are that many more issues that are left on the table. So I'd like your finding of fact 3, 4, 5, and 6 in the denial are all interrelated. They all go back to the open space access issue, which we feel we have addressed in good faith. 7, 8, 9 and 10, for all intents and purposes, say no dead, you haven't met the dead-end street standards. If that's the only issue, fine. Deny us on that, if you're going to deny us at all. I don't understand what item 12 says, but it doesn't strike me as a finding of fact. I mean, it's just, it's a, we're denied. So I would, I renew my objections to the other issues that you seek to drag back in if you're going to deny us. We're respectfully requesting approval tonight. I think you have it within your authority to do that.
Thank you, Mr. Cheney. You've made your position perfectly clear, I think. I do want to take issue with the, just slightly, and I don't mean to prolong this any more than we have to. I do not sense here that the town has been unfair, although I can understand that you would come to that conclusion. I do think that from what I can understand about the situation, it simply is something that was not flagged early on, and none of us are perfect. I don't have any difficulty in coming to a conclusion which is different from yours, that the town does have a particular interest in safety, not only the safety of the residents at the end of this very long road, but also the safety of the rescue personnel and whoever else it is who may have to answer a call down there. And it seems to me that, different people can come to different conclusions. I think we've plowed the ground quite a lot here, and certainly wanted to give you and Mr. Sprague every opportunity to try to present your case as well as possible. So we do have another matter on the agenda tonight, and I wonder if we can come to some kind of suggestion for a motion. Does anybody have any thing to present?
Before I make a motion, I just very quickly want to address two things. I too think it's embarrassing and unfortunate that the issue of the dead-end road was not brought up until late in the process. I think there are no excuses. The only I didn't pick up on it. Certainly, the source of that access was so far away from this plan, 9,000 and plus feet, that we didn't look up from the plan to look at the entirety until that far into the process. That's the only explanation I can give. I can say very clearly, because I was at the ordinance committee meeting and meetings when the issue of defining where the start point is, it was extremely clear at that time. I believe it was Bob Taylor was the only person from the public there. It was open to the public to for comment. It was not specifically to any one subdivision when it was discussed publicly, but I do remember Mr. Taylor saying, "You mean to tell me that we have to go back to this point?" And the council members, and I believe it was Janet McLaughlin and Wayne Creelman, and I can't remember the third council person at the time, said, "Yes, that is the intent." So to this one board member, the intent of that ordinance and measuring of that distance is extremely clear. And it was not intended, although Mr. Taylor was there for his own interests, it was not intended to discuss it in relation to any one subdivision. Stating that, it would be, I'm not here tonight to deny this. I think that the applicant can approach the town council with that very same question, trying to approach the town council. My motion will be to a motion to table. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision approval, a wetlands alteration permit and public access waivers for Ramshead, a four-lot subdivision located off of Charles E. Jordan Road, be tabled to the regular December 1992 meeting of the Planning Board with the consent of the applicant.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Discussion?
Is it appropriate to vote first and then ask the applicant?
Yes.
Okay. No further discussion. I'll call the question. All in favor of tabling the motion? All in favor of the motion, which is to table until the December meeting? All opposed? Do we have the consent of the applicant?
We're not willing to consent to the table.
Thank you, Mr. Schnee. We don't have the consent of the applicant to table. The applicant has requested a decision one way or the other this evening. Do I hear another motion? Ms. Lardner?
I propose the following finding of facts. One, Shaw Sprague has requested minor subdivision approval, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Ram's Head, a four-lot subdivision located at the end of Charles E. Jordan Road, which requires review under Section 16.3.1 of the Subdivision Ordinance, Section 19.3.904 of the Wetlands Regulations, and Section 19.4.2b, public access waiver. Two, the application was deemed complete in May 1992 and a public hearing was held at the June 1992 Planning Board meeting. Three, the Ram's Head four-lot subdivision will increase the intensity of use of the land and increase demand on public open space and recreational facilities. Four, the cumulative impact of the Ram's Head subdivision in conjunction with development of abutting residentially zoned land will create demand for open space and recreational areas, which is most appropriately provided for at the subdivision approval stage. Five, the town's legitimate interest in maintaining a minimum standard of public open space and recreation is substantially advanced by requiring subdivisions to make provision for open space and recreational areas. Six, the applicant has substantially addressed the requirements of Section 16.3.1Q with respect to open space, although minor amendments to the subdivision plat are still required. Seven, the proposed subdivision is located at the end of a dead-end street, which is 9,500 feet in length. Eight, the applicant has failed to provide a second means of access to the proposed subdivision in accordance with Section 16.3.1B and Section 16.3.2A9. Nine, the applicant did not have street profiles approved by the town engineer prior to March 13, 1968, and he did not have the street under actual construction as of March 12, 1968. Therefore, the applicant cannot avail himself of the grandfathering or savings clause found in Section 16.3.6B. 10. The Planning Board has consistently interpreted Section 16.3.2A9.4 to include in the dead-end street calculations that pre-existing street leading to the proposed subdivision. Excuse me one moment, I want to read this. Could someone help me? Is there something missing?
If you delete that and put A, I think it makes sense after calculation.
Yeah.
To include in a dead-end street calculation a pre-existing street.
That a pre-existing? Okay. Number 10 again. The Planning Board has consistently interpreted Section 16.3.2A9.4 to include in the dead-end street calculation that a pre-existing street leading to the proposed subdivision, if it is the only means of access. For example, that same interpretation was made with respect to the Highlands at Broad Cove and Stonegate Phase 4 subdivisions. 11, the applicant, no, excuse me. 11, the request for wetlands alteration permit and public access waivers are dependent on the design of the subdivision and cannot be separated from the current subdivision plan application or its approval. 12, the Ram's Head subdivision plans and materials submitted do not substantially comply with the subdivision and zoning ordinances in the comprehensive plan of the town of Cape Elizabeth. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision approval, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Ram's Head, a four-lot subdivision located off of Charles E. Jordan Road, be denied.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second the motion.
Mr. Edsel, second the motion. Do I hear any further discussion?
I'd like number 6 and number 10 to be reread, please.
I, I thought I heard some changes, and I missed them, too. Can you tell me what you've changed? Because I think, do you have it in writing or something?
Not completely. I'll read what I meant to say, and Maureen could perhaps clarify.
There was no change to 1, correct?
There was no change
until I got to number 6.
And I said something like, the applicant has substantially addressed the requirements of Section 16.3.1Q with respect to open space, although minor modifications to the plan are required.
May
still be required. My intent was that was addressing that a couple board members felt the plans need to be modified a little bit in the both the delineation of the open space area and the language describing that open space.
Could I suggest that you say the applicant has?
Mr. Cheney, I think this is inappropriate.
All right. I'm just trying to understand what it is you're voting on, that's all. You have a right at least to know what the vote is, what the motion is.
I think we can have it reread one more time.
Maureen, do you?
Maureen usually has.
Number 6, the applicant has substantially addressed the requirements of Section 16-3-1Q with respect to open space, comma, although minor amendments to the subdivision plat are required, period.
May be required.
Okay.
Actually, it should be are required because we actually agreed on a few that did.
Something I'd like to bring up for discussion is, does the board feel comfortable about Condition 9, or finding a fact number 9.
Why don't we clarify what the changes are on what you read first so
me.
We know what we're dealing with to start with.
On number 10, I believe I read it as written with the addition, the insertion of A between...
What I think you wanted to do was to delete that and substitute A.
Yes,
it was read that A.
I did say that A. Excuse me. That was my only intended change. I eliminated what we have as condition or finding number 11 and renumbered our findings 12 and 13 to read 11 and 12.
And you added on 11 at the tail end application or its approval.
Yes, thank you. And what I wanted to bring up for discussion, if someone didn't have any other questions, is about finding a fact number 9.
I think it should be.
Okay.
I have no problem with the way it's read.
Just so I'm clear, there was no change to 7, no change to 8, no change to 9.
Correct.
10 now reads... The only change to 10 was the insertion of A after that in the second sentence.
And the deletion of that. So it reads, in the dead-end street calculation, a pre-existing street.
I'm sorry. In the dead-end street calculation.
Delete that,
all right.
Strike that,
okay.
And insert in lieu thereof the letter A.
All right. You know one of my comments. I don't know what the relevance of the second sentence is, but so be it. Can I get some explanation as to what new 11 means?
I don't think you're entitled to it.
Okay. Fine.
But you may request it.
If I could have the written findings soon, I'd appreciate it.
I don't mean to be curt.
I know.
I guess to me it's quite self-explanatory. It says that the request for the other two, that the wetlands alteration permit and the request for the public access waivers are dependent on the design of the subdivision and can't be separated. I think what the import of that finding is that it would not be appropriate to vote on those two items separate and apart from the vote on the subdivision plan.
And you did add at the end of that, or its approval?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. It's been moved and seconded that the application be denied. Is there any further discussion or comment?
Just a quick comment. I'm disappointed that we've reached this point.
We're all disappointed.
All in favor of the motion to deny the application? Raise your right hand. All opposed? Mr. Parkhurst opposed. Thank you, gentlemen, for your hard work.
Thank you.
Ms. Kane, do you want to resume the chair?
Next item of business tonight is Cape Wood subdivision amendments, a request by James Development Company for the previously approved Cape Wood subdivision located at Mitchell and Cape Woods Road. We will be conducting a public hearing tonight in accordance with section 16-2-5. Do we have someone from James Development who could come up and briefly give us a thumbnail sketch of what's going on for the viewing audience?
Good evening, Madam Chairman, members of the board. I'm Dave Camilla, a civil engineer with Land Use Consultants, and I'm here on behalf of James Development Corporation, who is represented by Jim Hinman, who is also here tonight. We were here last month with a request to make some amendments to the existing grading plan of the Cape Woods project. This is a project that goes back a ways. It was originally approved by the board in 1986, and the original developer had some financial problems after completing the first eight units, and the project went back to the bank, People's Heritage, and this past year, Jim Hinman bought the project from the bank and has proceeded to finish the improvements and complete the buildings. As Jim got going along with the project, looking at what happened in the first phase of the project and looking at the way the project was designed, he determined that it would make sense to lower some of these building elevations to avoid excessive fill and the tree clearing that goes along with that. There were some problems in the first phase where a lot of the trees, because of the fill, died and had to be removed. And to avoid that and really meet the intent of what the original plan showed, we've come forward with this plan to lower the buildings. And I've tried to show here on the drawing what it is that we have in mind. Our first meeting last month, We had some buildings that we wanted to raise and some we wanted to lower. And what we have done since is looked at some of these foundation locations and made the determination that we no longer need to raise any buildings, but we still would like to lower certain buildings. And I have marked on the plan here the ones that we do propose to lower. Units 8 and 9, we would like to lower 3 feet from the original design. Units 5 and 6, we want to lower 3 feet. Units 7 and 8, we want to lower 4 feet. Units 9 and 10, we'd like to lower 3 feet. Units 11 and 12, we'd like to lower 2 feet. The remaining three duplexes, we're proposing to make no changes and leave those as the original design. We did have a site walk. After the last meeting, the board was interested in going out and seeing for themselves just exactly what was going on. And we did meet out there on Saturday at the end of October. And we had some discussions about landscaping materials, which some of the abutters had some concerns about in this area. And after that site walk, we got together with the planner, Maureen, and we agreed to add some additional landscaping materials, and they're shown on this drawing here in this area on both sides of the sewer easement. We've proposed to add an additional 10 hemlocks, 5 to 6 feet high. And they will essentially close up this opening that was left from the original proposed landscaping along the sewer easement. We made one other change, which was something that was left over from the original developer's work. The driveway to units 5 and 6 was already constructed, and under the original design, it would have been moved over in here where there were some existing trees. So in order to save those trees, we have relocated this driveway to units 5 and 6 on the plan in conformance with what was built during construction. So we will be able to save some mature trees in this area. Basically, that's the extent of our proposal. We're not proposing to move any buildings. We're going to leave the roads and utilities and the drainage system as originally designed. And our only intent here is to make some what we consider to be relatively minor changes that will benefit our project as well as produce something that is going to be in everyone's best interest. And we're doing what we can to be good neighbors with the landscaping, and we would like to see our project approved tonight, and we're here to answer questions and do what we can to persuade you that this is a good idea, and vote favorably on it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Camilla. I'll open the public hearing. I would ask those that are going to speak to come to the podium, announce your name and where you live. Keep your comments on point and as succinct as possible. Do we have anyone? The public hearing is now open. Is anyone going to speak? Would someone like to? Yes.
Hello. I'm Barbara McCusick. I live with my husband, Paul Liscord, and our two children at 14 Woodcrest Road. That's right here, so you can see we're very close to the project. I want to thank the board for carefully considering Mr. Hinman's request and for doing a site walk. I really appreciate the time that you've taken to take a look at the project. Of course, we'd be happier if we were still living next to 16 acres of undeveloped woods, and we're very upset that the development was approved the first time around, and now I think that we're just in a situation where we want to make the best of what we've got here. At the last meeting, Mr. Hinman, I guess basically what I want to say is we're here in support of James Development's request for lowering the elevation of the buildings. I think that's a good thing and will lessen the impact of the development on our property. And I know at the last meeting, Mr. Hinman said that he had no problem planting the trees in the spring. And since that meeting, during the site walk, he has told us that he'll work with us on the plantings and the placement of the plantings so that we can get the greatest benefit from the landscaping. Do you have any questions for me at all?
No, thank you, Barbara.
Okay, thanks.
My name is Dan Willett, and I'm a resident at 22 Cape Woods Drive, and I'd just like to express my support for James Development's proposal. As was mentioned before, the association incurred large expenses to remove trees that were dying because of the previous design, and believe that Jim's plan would prevent that from happening for the remainder of the project.
Thank you, Mr. Willett.
I'm Judith Cedar, and I live at 10 Woodcrest Road, which is listed as the Karen residence, but they've since moved. And I also, in indicated last time we were here that I think it's called the footprint of the house is not correct right here either. It's larger. I had put in a substantial addition on my house to take advantage of the woods, and unfortunately I was not aware of Mr. Hinman's purchase of the undeveloped part of the original project. In the best of all worlds, I wish I could compensate Mr. Hinman in some way so that I could eliminate this unit over here, but I'm sure that's unrealistic and impossible. So what I'm asking tonight, given that it's a fait accompli and he's obviously made a careful, studied investment here, which I'd like to be supportive of, what I would like to do, given that we do have 20/20 hindsight now, is to try to preserve the woods as best we can. I think that we all agreed last time, and I think the site visit hopefully confirmed this for you, that the woods have been pretty well destroyed as a result of the first owner's neglect. And my concern here is that we take advantage of our 20/20 hindsight and attempt to rebuild what can be rebuilt, or, I mean, reforested, and also try very hard to preserve what is already there. Clearly, I have my own personal private interest, which is the loss of privacy. For the 3 years that I've had it, I've enjoyed that. There is clearly a deer path that runs through here, and I don't know where the deer will go, but I guess they'll go someplace else. But my concern is that Mr. Hinman has not fully addressed the issue of keeping the forest healthy, and also not fully addressed the issue of planting more trees, helping the forest to be able to be maintained. What concerns me a lot is that the trees here are not drawn to scale. So if when we look at this, it looks really nice and it looks great, but they're way out of whack. I mean, I'm not sure, but I thought I heard somebody mention that if you look at the scale, these trees would measure 25 feet or something across. And clearly, you know, that's not reality. So adding 10 trees is quite disappointing to me. I don't think that's going to do it. The last time I was here, I made note of, I think it's that section of the code which indicates that the town wants a buffer to exist between new developments and old ones. I appreciate that my idea of a buffer may not be the board's idea of a buffer, and certainly may not be Mr. Hinman's idea of a buffer. So I guess maybe in part I'm asking for special consideration. I do that though within the context of preserving the forest, the woods. You know, with this new development, I can now see lights where I couldn't see lights before. I look out from my house, I can see the roads, Hemlock, and maybe Mitchell. I'd have to check, but I know when I'm on those roads, I can now see my house where I couldn't before, and I can also, you know, see lights and cars and houses and whatnot. I appreciate, again, going back to the idea of what constitutes a buffer. Best of all possible worlds, again, what I'd like to see is at least in the area directly affecting my property that Mr. Hinman put in substantially more hemlocks and put them, I think it's, I indicated in my letter what my research came up with. I don't know if it's 4 feet center from center or whatever. We have to refer back to my letter. I appreciate that he wants to maintain the look of a forest, which would mean that the hemlocks would be planted sporadically. Unfortunately, I appeal to you in the area of, just being sensitive, I guess, to my own private needs, and that may be very inappropriate. I know you want me to stop. So what I'm asking is more trees, and I don't know how much negotiation we have on the construction of a buffer, but at the very least, more trees. There's nothing here. And again, because of the topography, and I think this is really important, unless the topography is taken into account, Mr. Hinman could probably plant 500 trees, and it wouldn't constitute what I think is an adequate buffer because of the lay of the land. So I'd like an escrow account set aside. I'd like some guarantee as to how many trees he's going to plant, and I'd like to have a consultant available who could come in and independently of the project sort of look at the land and say, to really have a good buffer, this is where the trees are to be planted. I mean, I don't know where they should be planted. I'm not a landscape architect. I don't know if I don't think Mr. Hinman is. We're both in different businesses. So those are some of the priorities I'd like to see addressed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak? I'm always at this impasse. Do I close it and then have the applicant? Yes, thank you. I'll get it right by the time I have my last meeting. This public hearing is closed. I would ask the applicant to respond if he'd like to any of the comments. If nothing?
I guess we have no comment at this point.
That's fine. Then why don't we just turn it back to the board here? Do we have any discussion by the board?
Madam Chair?
Ms. Lardner? Oh, and before I go any further, we are short one member still, and in Tom Emery-Stead, I'll point you to vote on this issue, Judy, if you'd like. Yes, you.
Okay.
Judy.
Sure. Thank you. Some questions for the applicant to clarify. There's a note on, I think it's only on the landscaping plan, called the tree preservation note, which I applaud the intent of that, but where are the tree preservation areas?
Well, they aren't delineated on the plan, and this is something that we discussed with Maureen. It's left to the applicant to delineate those in the field, and what we agreed to do was he would use survey flagging, colored ribbon, and surround the areas of trees that are going to be preserved, and that would then be the areas that he can't drive equipment in, store materials in, or do any tree cutting in. We don't have a detailed survey of existing trees. All these plans represent our areas where we would like to save trees. That's not to say that this area, for example, there's trees along the entire perimeter of that. We don't know exactly where those trees exist, so it would be impossible for us to delineate specifically on the plan. So it's sort of with good faith, I guess, that we're going to go forward on this, and that was how we left it. It seemed to be appropriate at the time. I don't think was the intent that this would be an absolute boundary line. You know, there are things that have to happen on the site, like utilities and so forth, that cross through some of these areas. We're going to minimize that to the extent that we can, but the way we left it, Jim would determine where he needed to lay utilities, and then the areas that he was able to stay out of, he would flag and leave those alone and
I will,
not disturb.
I'm going to go to the planner and come back. For all intents and purposes, to me, the applicant could choose to preserve any or all trees, and we can't count on any particular trees or areas of trees being preserved, correct?
The way I would approach it is I agree with Dave Camilla that it's questionable how many trees are going to be preserved. The way I would approach it is I would look at the plan and the area which I referred to as the cloud areas, that kind of squiggly plan that's mm-hmm. supposed to incorporate buffer. The thing is, we don't know whether in any one place there is a tree in there that can be preserved. If there's a tree in the middle of one of those areas and there isn't going to be any grading nearby, then the town should be demanding that that tree be preserved. And I think what we're saying is that prior to any construction, that the applicant would have to go in with the surveyor's tape and show the area that will be preserved. And what that does is it takes a plan that really is more conceptual than specific, and it brings it into the field where you actually have the edge of grading and the activity of construction versus trees that are going to be preserved. The question is, in, for example, that upper corner in that narrow band, is there a tree in that narrow band? We're talking about a wooded area that trees may be 15, 25 feet apart. There's not enough information on this plan right now, and unfortunately, when the board originally approved this, there were not delineation of specific trees. Probably today, if we were going to do that, we would try to get a little bit more specific information, and if we thought there wasn't going to be anything left, maybe ask for some from new plantings. But this seems to me to be a very pragmatic approach to trying to make sure that whatever trees that are can reasonably be preserved in light of the kind of construction that has to occur will be preserved.
I just have to say, the way it's written now, I would not take any hope that any single tree on that lot would be preserved. I don't see any bite in it at all. And if mm-hmm. you could think of some additional language, and certainly I would not see this as before the plan being approved, maybe a condition of approval saying something like any trees that can reasonably be preserved shall be preserved and you will use this method for preserving them. But do you see my point that I...
Yeah, I guess I'm seeing it more as I think there's enough there in terms of enforcement. If there's a tree located within those areas that are the kind of the cloud areas, and the problem is those definition of those buffer areas, I'm not convinced that those took into consideration the grading and drainage work that has to be done. So in having the applicant put out the surveyor tape, you're bringing together the construction and the grading and the preservation needs at the same time. And I would argue, and in bringing out the code enforcement officer and the town engineer and the tree warden, that if we felt that the applicant was exceeding grading or activity of the construction area, that we would be able to limit it by using that preservation note.
Okay. I don't want to hold it up for that. Mr. Camilla, can you comment on the town engineer's comments regarding the driveways to units 9 and 10 and 13 and 14, saying he feels the grade is too steep as drawn now, and what solution, if any, you're proposing?
Well, I read the comment, I guess, in the best of all worlds, if we could keep our driveways to 5%, that would be wonderful. This site, if you were on the sidewalk, I think you were, you see the kind of terrain that we're dealing with. What we're doing with our grade reductions is making these situations better than they were in the original plan. I took a quick look at the old plan, and I think those two units, the driveway grades were like 9 and 10% under the original design, so we've reduced them some. I also think that the town engineer was looking at the area immediately adjacent to the garages. If you look at the overall slope of the driveways, they're somewhat less than that, and I think they are less than 5%. I went back and looked at some references I had just as a point of reference. The American Society of Civil Engineers, along with the Urban Lands Institute and I think the American Society of Landscape Architects, publishes a book about residential streets. They just came out with a new edition in 1990. And their recommendation for road grades, this is roads, not driveways, this is streets, like public streets, they recommend up to 12% grades. And if you're in areas with severe icing, they recommend that maximum go down to 8%, which I guess would apply in New England, so that an 8% maximum is what they would consider to be good for a roadway with a lot of traffic. So generally driveways are less restrictive than the overall roadway. So I think you could even go further than that and deal with a 10 or 12% driveway without any problem. I know from my own experience, we've designed them before in those ranges, and people seem to be able to get in and out okay. You know, ideally, 5% is wonderful. That's what the, Americans with Disabilities Act basically ask you to do for parking lots and things like that. And where we can live with that. And it may be possible that when Jim actually builds these driveways that he can, you know, make some modifications in the field to these grades. These grading plans aren't intended to be that precise. You know, the contours are on there. However, the actual construction in the field isn't going to be held to that specific grade line. This isn't like spot elevation. So I think it's somewhat conceptual. And when Jim actually builds these, I think that you'll see that they won't be quite that steep, right adjacent to the garages at least, so that I think what we're doing is going to work fine, and I don't think we're creating an unsafe situation. I don't think, though, that we could live with an arbitrary number like 5% just because of the terrain that we're dealing with here. It's just a practical issue that we can't do anything about. That's what Mother Nature has dealt us here. We're making it somewhat better, but unfortunately, we can't create a flat site from what we have here to begin with.
We have had comments that the foundation drains may not drain to daylight and that sump pumps may be used instead. Do we know exactly what units are going to have sump pumps versus the foundation drains?
We propose those in all units.
But the plans still show foundation drains around them. Is that
we correct? Haven't taken that detail off the plan. However, there is a note, and I am not sure which plan it's on at this point. Probably the drainage plan that says there will be, you know, sump pumps in each unit.
So they may be drained to sump pumps.
Yeah, I mean, I think Jim's intent is to put one in every building just to be on the safe side. If they're not necessary, that's great. But, you know, there's a lot of ledge blasting and tree clearing that would be required just to get a foundation drain out to a positive outfall. If you look at the plan,
the reason for getting away from foundation drains is because you take out trees when you blast.
Would you be willing on the note on the drainage plan to simply state that the sump pumps will be used instead of the gravity foundation drains? Okay, just so there's no misunderstanding if someone looks at this and
if you want to make that a condition of approval, I think that, you know, would be perfectly acceptable to us.
This is something I hadn't thought of before. Maybe, I don't know if we had seen it or not. These proposed tree lines of the existing woods, there were existing woods shown in the center of the cul-de-sac, and clearly there are no trees left now. How do you propose to treat that area?
We showed nothing on the plan, although I know Jim in the back of his mind would like to landscape that area. He felt, you know, there was it might create a distraction, if you will, if he proposed that now, so he left it, you know, as it was drawn.
What are you proposing or thinking of? No. Can you be serious? Are you going to loam and seed it? What were you going to do?
Well,
originally designed, it said they were going to preserve the trees, and
they didn't.
Okay, then maybe there will be a condition of approval on how to landscape that. And if you would have some ideas, I'd love to hear them instead of us being arbitrary.
Mr. Hinman, could you come to the microphone?
Yes, I'm very happy to thank you.
That way everyone else can hear.
When I entered into this, I was the one that asked to lower the foundation to save trees. Nobody asked me. Everything that has been put out here, I have done to preserve trees. So don't beat me up on the trees.
Mr. Hinman, I'm not trying to. I like to have all the I's dotted and T's crossed. I can say right now I'm in favor.